Thank you very much, first of all, to the organizers. And want to say two things. First of all, there will be some overlapping with the talk by Gigliola this morning. Not this morning, a few minutes ago. Jet lag problems. And another thing is that I say 3D, but I start with a simple situation 2D, okay? Just to give an idea of the technique. And they are joined to, this is a joint work with Fabrice Planchon and Nikolai Tsetkov. So, what's the plan? Well, I just start a very, very simple situation about the Cauchy theory. So I want to say very quickly how to solve the Cauchy theory locally and globally in time. And once you have a global solution, you want to understand the properties for the large times. In particular, we are interested in the issue of the growth of Sobolev norms to deduce some upper bound, the polynomial bound that Gigliola was mentioning before, but in a general setting. Okay? We have no structure on the manifold, it is not necessarily a torus, we have no periodicity, it's just a 3D or 2D compact manifold without any further assumptions. And I want to compare, in some sense, the classical strategy by Bourguin to prove this polynomial growth with an alternative possibility, which is based on the use of modified energies. And we shall see that in 2D we get more general results in some sense, and in 3D I think that you get some new result that as far as you can see you cannot get by using the Bourguin technique. At least we were not able to do that. And then if there is time, but maybe not, I will say how this technique can give even better result in 1D. Again, about this issue of the size of the growth. Now, what is the problem? It is the same by Gigliola a few minutes ago. And here we assume, in general, this for simplicity, I assume a pure power nonlinearity, but since now I tell you that this technique that we use allows you to deal also with more general potential. On the contrary, it's not completely clear to me that the Bourguin technology can work also for rougher nonlinear potential. But for simplicity, let's work in the pure power case. We are in this setting, so MD will be a d-dimensional compact manifold. Laplacian G is the Laplace-Beltrami operator. S is the regularity of the initial data. And at least you hope that for an initial data in HS, you propagate the regularity HS for every times. And you want to understand this growth of HS. But let's go step by step. And the special case that we will be interested in is the following. So 2D, essentially, M2 is a general compact manifold, and P is any integer nonlinearity. So no restriction to the cubic case. And in 3D, we can deal with the cubic case, and we can say something in the subcubic case. Okay? This is, but without any assumption on the topology of the manifold. So this is the usual. We learned what is the focusing between this morning and the Gigliola thing. And so as you can see, I assume here the sign plus, which is the same, is the opposite of the other one. So we get a positive energy. So what is sure is that the H1 norm, if the solution exists, cannot blow up, not even at infinity. So no problem about the growth of H1. And let me spend a few words about the local and global Cauchy theory, because if you want to start to analyze the long-time behavior, let's start by the local, by the global existence of one solution. So what is the status of the art as far as I know? So in 2D, give me any 2D compact manifold, give me any nonlinearity, no restriction, not necessarily cubic, then the Cauchy problem is locally well posed in H1. So once you are locally well posed in H1, for free, you globalize just by the conservation. What is the other result that you can prove? Well, in 3D, give me any 3D compact manifold, give me any initial data in H1 plus epsilon, then for cubic, then you can solve the cubic NLS in this regularity. And you see already in 3D, the globalization is not free, because you can solve locally in time in H1 plus epsilon. So this is essentially what I said before. So in 2D, the globalization is free because you are at the level of the energy. In 3D, the globalization argument is much more involved. It is due to Burke-Gerard and Tsvetkov. OK, but I will come back to this approach later on. But just let me say a few words. So what is the already this first point here. Second point here is not free. It's not free. It's you need to work, especially on generic compact manifold, because the free result is the following. If you are in 2D, what is really easy and trivial is to solve locally in time in H1 plus epsilon. So already the globalization if you, in 2D, if you just rely on the Sobolev embedding, is not free. And in 3D, just by using this Sobolev embedding, you have to work in H3 over 2 plus epsilon. In the previous slide, I said H1 plus epsilon, H1. Why you can do that? Well, because instead of just using Sobolev embedding, we have to use the Stricker's estimate. So you have to put in the game the dispersion in a more serious way, not just by L2 estimate plus Sobolev embedding. And I also want to mention one result that was not mentioned today, at least, which is the, as far as you know, is the first global existence result for NLS in 2D, which is the result by Brezis and Galouet, who say the following. They are able to globalize in 2D for cubic NLS any solution with initial data in H1 plus epsilon. That you cannot use that just by conservation law, but you have to add this extra Sobolev embedding. You see, this Sobolev embedding in 2D, you want to control L infinity in principle with H1, but you cannot. So you need to add some high frequency contribution, but this high frequency contribution can be hidden in the log. And this is something that helps to globalize. And you globalize, and moreover, you get also a bound, which is double exponential. So H1 plus epsilon cannot blow up in finite time. And moreover, you have the double exponential bound. Okay. How you can improve the situation? Well, to improve the situation, you have to play with the dispersion. So you start to look, as Giuliola said before, at some smoothing effect on the free waves. So you look at free waves, you take an initial data phi, you take the free evolution, and you start to look at some regularity, which is not necessarily L infinity L2, but you start to play with LPLQ, with the PLQ that move under this condition, which is typical for Stricker's estimate. But what you see is that in general, if you are on RD, you can control this quantity by L2. If you are on a generic compact manifold of dimension D, you have to lose derivatives, and the loss is of the order 1 over P, where P is the regularity in time. Of course, in the situation that Giuliola was mentioning before, where M2 is T2, you can do much better. But this result is true in general for every compact manifold. This is the main difference between this thing and the one on T2. And this result, as far as I know, was proved in the same time. I don't know the details of this thing, but between Bjork, Gerard, and Svetkov in the same time by Staffilani and Tatar. So we want to take advantage of this to solve our Cauchy problem, at least locally in time, at low regularity. More precisely, in H1 in 2D, in H1 plus epsilon in 3D. And, okay, let me go further. And let me explain very quickly why this Stricker's estimate helps to solve, at least in 2D, with initial data in H1, not anymore in H1 plus epsilon. Well, you see, the game is very easy. The slide before implies this Stricker's estimate. You see, I lose 1 over r derivative if I take LR regularity, and this number here exactly the one for which r and this number here is Stricker's admissible. This estimate is proved, and thanks to a Sobolev embedding, I go in L infinity. How many derivatives I need? I need 1 minus 1 over r derivative, and this 1 minus r derivative gives me here h1, and thanks to this estimate, you see, I can control L infinity just by H1, that I cannot do for the time-independent Sobolev embedding, but I can do that thanks to the dispersion along free waves. If you combine this estimate with this free, essentially, estimate on the Duhamel term, you get global existence in H1 and global solution because of the conservation law. This is the 2D situation, so the globalization comes for free. Now, which are the questions we are interested in? Well, as I told you, we have a in 2D at least, you start with an initial data in H1, and you have a global solution in H1. You can also prove, without big efforts, that the HS regularity is preserved along the evolution. So if you start from HS, which is very big, for every time you remain HS, But what is not so clear is whether or not this HS norm remains bounded or not. Okay, if there are solutions that whose HS norm grows or not, and if it grows, how fast you can grow. The second, even more basic question is there at least one solution that grows in when t goes to plus infinity, at least for higher order Sobolev norm? Well, the answer to this question, at least on 2D compact manifold, is still open. But there are some results in more in other situations, like cylindrical symmetry on the manifold and so on. And there are several fundamental papers on this topic, starting from Burgain. Here it is a list of names, not necessarily working with the Schrödinger equation, but the same question you can ask for generic dynamical systems. And here it is a list of names. And okay, I don't want to stay too much on this slide, but let me come now to the first remark already done by Gigliola. If you start to ask yourself if there is growth of Sobolev norms in R2, it is impossible, simply because the nonlinear solutions scatter. Since they scatter, they behave for large times like free waves, and for free waves, HS is bounded, is constant. So at least you cannot grow. So M2 is not so interesting. So in some sense, what is more interesting is the compact case. And another remark is that, okay, once you have a reasonable Cauchy theory in H1, which is the case thanks to the estimate by Gigliola and Tataru and Bjorkstrand and Zvetkov, then for free you get an exponential growth on the HS norm. Okay, why? Simply because in general, just by tame estimate, you can show that the HS norm, after an increment tau that depends just on the size of initial data, you can control this HS with a constant time this. You iterate this bound, and for free you get exponential, which is better than the double exponential by Brazier and Galway, for example. Okay? So and moreover, this is... Yes. Yeah, not growth bound. At most, the growth can be exponential. Okay. An upper bound for the growth. Okay. But you can we do something better or not? Well, there is the already mentioned work by Burgain, who worked in T2, cubic nonlinearity, and he was able to show that, in fact, you have polynomial growth. And for instance, I don't say that this is a big issue, but for instance, if you look at the same question for higher order nonlinearity, I don't know any written results in the literature telling you that you have polynomial growth. Okay, but the technique by Burgain in this context should work. And what is the basic idea of Burgain? The basic idea of Burgain is to prove this bound here. Okay, it is based on some smoothing estimate in XSB spaces, but the key estimate is this one. You see, you want control the HS minus at an increment tau, which depends just on the size of phi, minus the initial data t, with one constant, but the power here has to be below 2. If you are below 2, then just by an elementary argument, you introduce this quantity alpha n, which is the solution at this sequence of time tau n. Then you write down this estimate implies this thing here, this inequality here, and just by simple iteration, you forget this polynomial bound. N to 1 over epsilon means polynomial bound. But how Burgain could prove this kind of bound here? Okay, it is fundamental that the constant C here is equal to 1. If you get another constant, the best you can do is exponential. But here you can get a big constant, but less exponent. Okay, this is the game. And the idea of Burgain is very, very simple, is the following. Okay, we have to measure the difference in HS at two different times, T1 and T2. What to do? Well, start with the fundamental theorem of calculus. This is the NDT of this. You compute this time derivative. This is real part of this quantity. And now what he does? Well, he replaces ut by the equation. Now, when you replace ut by the equation, you have the linear part that just by simple self-adjointness argument is imaginary, so it disappears. And you end up just with the nonlinear part replaced in ut bar, imaginary part. Okay? And here, for simplicity, I call 2s1 equal s. Well, s is the regularity of the Sobolev norm that you want to understand. And now it is the key point. If you work a bit, you see that this Laplacian 2s1 is Laplacian s1 to the square, so you can put s1 derivative on the nonlinearity. Now, when the Laplacian is 1 falls here, you get 0 because you have imaginary part. So the most complicated thing is to deal when the Laplacian falls on this term, more specifically, not in the bar. And this is the most dangerous term that you have to control. Okay? But at the end of the story, you see, you start to control HS. You still get, in this quantity here, Laplacian square. So it is not so clear how you can go down to 2 minus epsilon on the growth. But the magic thing is that here you have the bar. And this is what the Burgain spaces like a lot. The bar may give some miracle. Okay? So you have to play with these XSB spaces. You have to spend some regularity in time given by B to gain something in space. And you can go down with the power of Laplacian SU.
Maybe you can write what is the definition of X?
So X, I'm not really an expert of this, but I can try. So you have to write this. One possibility is to take the solution. This can be adapted to general dispersive equation. So you act with the free dynamics on your function U. And then you take the usual HS in HB in T, HS in X. Okay, but acting with the free evolution. And so you have B is in some sense the regularity in time, S is the regularity in X, and thanks to this definition, you can play a lot to push some regularity from B to S. This is the miracle that allows you in some sense to get a smaller power than 2 in X. Okay? And this is the game of Burgain. Now, what we can say, what is our result? Well, the result that we can prove is the following. Okay, what is the assumption? We assume that we can control L4 for free waves with S0 epsilon loss, with S0 loss. S0 can be chosen to be equal to epsilon if M2 is T2, but in the worst case, it is proved in these 2 papers here that if S0 is 1/4, then it is always satisfied. So it is never empty, this assumption, at the level of free waves. And our theorem is the following. Consider NLS onto D with any nonlinearity, not necessarily the cubic one, no extra assumption on M2, then you have this polynomial growth. Okay? You can also, this S0 is the one responsible of the loss of derivative in the free Stricker's estimate. And this S is the regularity that you want to measure. And this we can prove without seeing any difference between cubic, higher order nonlinearity, and so on and so forth. And can be adapted, as I told you, not necessarily to the pure power case. It is just a question, in some sense, of integration by parts, as we shall see. It is a different strategy compared with the one by Burgain. And you should also say that the previous result, at least in the cubic case, was obtained by Zong. And they also have to say that we never used the XSB spaces, at least here. Probably by combining this technique with XSB, we can still improve. This is something that we are thinking about. But for the moment, let me go really with the simplest thing that you can do. And what is the key point? The key point is that we don't use. We introduce some modified energies. Okay? So I should say that the use of modified energies is not something new in the literature. It has been used at least in those papers, but even in other papers. But what we did is to combine the, first of all, every problem has its own modified energy. Second thing, we combined this with the dispersion, which is something not done before in some sense. Okay? And how to proceed. We proceed like this, okay. You see, we introduce this energy here, which looks a bit strange, I agree with you, but I will do some comments in a few minutes. But you see, the leading term is the H2 norm square, but we subtract some quantities which are there with appropriate coefficient. Why? Well, because when we compute dndt of this modified energy, see what happens. You have the first term involves just one derivative, so no second derivative. On the contrary, Burgain add Laplacian to the square. You have just one derivative. Here you have one derivative, and here you have dtu. But dtu, if you replace the equation, gives you Laplacian u, but to the power 1, not to the power 2, as Burgain did before. And here we are controlling the h2 squared. So immediately, just by the cancellation caused by this time derivative, you gain 1 power of the Laplacian. And here it is where you gain the polynomial bounds. Okay. And just to give, yes. So what to do? Well, notice that this energy is constructed in such a way that you have some algebraic cancellation when you compute the time derivative. But essentially, the leading term is this term to the square. Because in the second term, you have the Laplacian u, which appears in a linear way. And here, it does not even appear. So essentially, at E2, if you control E2, essentially, you are controlling H2. Okay. And so if you integrate this relation here, what you get? You get that E2, but essentially H2 to the square minus H2 to the square at time 0 can be controlled by the integral 0t of the right-hand side here. And the most delicate term to be controlled are the following one, you see. You have this term, and here you just use Euler, nothing more than that. You put this dtu in L2. You put u in L infinity because you are 1D, you are 2D, and in 2D essentially you can control L infinity by H1 plus epsilon. And you just need to put radius square in L2, which is exactly this W14 to the square. So at the end of the story, what you have to control is essentially this L4 in time W14 in X. And this you can do just by the dispersion. You do that and you conclude the proof that does not depend on the structure of the nonlinearity, does not depend on the fact that you have a pure power, and so on and so forth. This is the 2D that we did for an exercise to understand how to deal with the 3D case. And just to give a very rough idea of where this energy comes from, where you see the beginning is exactly the computation of Burgen. Burgen said, OK, let's compute dN dt of h2 squared. So you have to compute dN dt of this Laplacian u L2 squared. This first identity is the same as Burgen. Also here, you replace by the equation. And you end up with this. The point is that Burgen said, OK, I am enough like this. What we do is the following. This time dt, we put outside, you see? And if you put dN dt outside, that can be absorbed in the energy. Of course, you have to move dt also on the nonlinearity. And you keep doing this game. And at the end of the story, you conclude, you construct step by step the modified energy. This is how this modification appears in some sense. But after this cancellation, the bad term by Burgen is disappeared. Okay? And the remaining term involved just Laplacian u to power 1. No more Laplacian u to power square, which was the dangerous term. Okay? And of course, we don't exploit too much the algebraic structure of the remainder. For the remainder, we just put absolute value and we put Euler. But probably playing more with the remainder, we can also improve what we do. Okay? And another important thing is that this computation does not depend on the fact that you are in the flat case or not, even if it apparently there are hidden some integration by parts, just because this fundamental identity here, that is, of course, true in the flat case, is true without any modification on every compact matrix. It does not depend on the curvature. Okay? So the tool that you need is essentially hidden here. Okay, this is how you deal with the piece of the energy, but let me go further, and let me come now to what we can do in the 3D case. Okay, so in the 2D case, every 2D compact manifold, for every 2D compact manifold, every nonlinearity, you have growth, polynomial growth. Okay, what we want to do in 3D? Well, in 3D, on a generic compact manifold, first of all, let's ask ourselves, for which nonlinearity we have a global dynamic, first of all. And the unique case that I know is for cubic and subcubic nonlinearity. So if you give me something which is a cubic plus epsilon, and you don't assume nothing on the geometry of the manifold, I don't even know if there is a global solution. Okay? But in this situation, you have a global solution. And the point is how to guarantee that you can globalize the solution. Because you see, assume that we start in 3D. Okay, we are in 3D, we take initial data H2. The local existence result comes for free just by Sobolev embedding, because 2 is above 3 over 2. Question, can we globalize or not? which you cannot do that for free. And as far as you know, the first answer to this question is by Bjork, Jurand, and Zakharov, and they give you very quickly their strategy. In this way, you can see where you gain if you use the modified energies. The strategy is very simple. Okay, you write down the integral equation satisfied by U, and you apply Minkowski inequality. So the L infinity H2 norm of the solution is controlled by H2 of the initial data, just by the Duhamel formula, plus L1 H2 of the nonlinear term. And the nonlinear term is cubic. Okay? Now, let's go to the second step. H2 of this cubic term can be controlled by H2 at power 1, and then, of course, you have to put this term in L infinity. And you get L2 in time, L infinity in x to the power 2. Question, how to control L2 L infinity? Because you cannot rely anymore on a Sobolev embedding. Okay, if you rely on Sobolev embedding, you lose other power of H2, and you cannot do that. So here it comes the idea of Bjork, Jurand, and Zetkov to use the dispersion, so the Strickert's estimate I was mentioning before. And the target is the following. The target is to show that L2 L infinity to the square can be controlled by this log. You see? If I can put here the log, then I imagine here a log, I am exactly in the position to apply a kind of Grönwald lemma that gives for free also a double exponential bound. Now, how to control for the nonlinear solution L2 L infinity? You have to use the so-called Strickert's estimate, but in this version. Okay, just a few comments about the Strickert's version that you need to use. Well, in general, when you write down Strickert's estimate, what you have to do? Well, you have a nonlinear solution. In general, you need also a forcing term because you have to work with the Duhamel operator with initial condition equal phi. Okay? And in general, what you expect? You expect to control some norm of V by using what? By using some HS norm of the initial data, which is what you expect if you don't have forcing data, plus another norm that involves just F. This is not the case of this family of Strickert's estimate for two reasons. The first reason is that you have the projector Pn, but this is something that is not a serious problem because the projector commutes with the equation, so if you localize the forcing term and the initial data, you have no problem. But the key point is that here you don't take some norms of the initial datum phi. You have to exploit the solution himself. Okay? For f you have a norm. But for the, here you don't have just phi, you have the evolution u. Of course, if f is equal to zero, it's the same thing because h1 half is preserved along the evolution, or this is essentially the h1 half norm of the initial data. But if f is not zero, you don't control anymore in the standard way by Strickert's. Okay? This is the key remark. And why you have to do that? Because if you play like in a non-clever way with the TT star argument, you lose derivative on the forcing term, and it kills you. In this way, you don't lose derivative on the forcing term. But the price that you pay is that here you have the whole solution u, not just the initial datum. Okay? And this is, technically, this comes from what? Well, it comes from the fact that when you write down the Strickert's estimate on a compact manifold, when the frequency grows, the times on which you have the Strickert's, they come with semi-classical times. Okay? So, what to do? You do the TT star for semi-classical times, and then you sum up. If you sum up and then you apply the so-called Christe-Kiselev argument, you lose two derivatives, and you are killed. In this way, by this cutoff in time, you are safe because you don't lose nothing here, which is fundamental. Okay? And now how to proceed? How do they proceed? Well, they say, okay, now imagine that in our case, of course, f is u cube, because we want to apply this estimate to the nonlinear solution. And what you do? Well, you sum up, you take those estimates. Since you want to control L2 L infinity, and here you control L2 L6, you have to lose one half derivative. You lose one half derivative. One half derivative here becomes one derivative here. And here you lose one half derivative. And then they sum up, because this is an estimate true for localized solution, but you have to sum up on the frequencies. So you have a sum of this term here plus a sum of those term here over capital N. And you just use Minkowski on the left-hand side. This is where you lose a bit, because you use Minkowski, and when you sum up, you have to lose something. But let me come a bit later on this point. And essentially, what is the estimate? We are arrived at this estimate here. And let's check that this is not a problem. This is not a problem. Why? Well, because you see, I have this estimate in W1 half 6 over 5. I want to remove the sum. But to remove the sum is free if I can lose derivative. I can put one derivative here and then remove the sum. And when I remove the sum, you see what I can do. I put a gradient in L2 and U square in L3. And I get H1, L6 squared, which are conserved by the Hamiltonian. So the unique term which is dangerous to sum up is the term coming from here. When you sum up the L2 in time, H1 in X of the projected pieces of the solution. And how do they solve the problem? Well, you split this sum in high frequency and the low frequency part, where N0 is a frequency that we will select later on. You see, this sum, you split below N0, above N0. When you are above N0, you can gain 1 over N here if you lose H2. This is for free. And when you work at low frequency, you just do Cauchy-Schwarz. You do Cauchy-Schwarz, you take a square root of log of N0, which is the amount of the dyadic number below N0, and then you sum up the square. You continue this estimate, and at the end, you see where the log comes from. Okay? Just because you have to select in an appropriate way the frequency N0. But what is the problem is that you have to sum up without the square. If you could sum up with the square, you lose nothing. Okay? And this is what we can do with the modified energy, essentially. We avoid the usage of L infinity and Minkowski. You can use just square of quantity, so you can use all the power of the harmonic analysis with the squared function. Okay? And now the conclusion, at least for them, is easy, because now I have controlled L2 in time, L infinity in X, by this log, you replace there, and you just apply Gronwall. But since you have this quantity times the log, you have double exponential. Okay? Now, what do we want to prove for 3D? In which sense we can improve? Well, we can improve in the following sense. We have two kinds of results. The first one is for cubic, the same nonlinearity treated by Burk, Gerard, and Zwetkov. And what we say is that in the cubic case, okay, global existence is already proved by themselves, but we reprove the global existence with a better bound. We just take exponential, which is what you expect in some sense. Okay? But you cannot prove with their strategy. And the other thing that we can prove is that if you take something slightly below cubic, so in the subcubic case, then you get also polynomial. Okay? But why in this statement I put hm with m generic and here I put h2? Well, because if p is not enough regular, then it's not so clear that higher order Sobolev norm, higher regularity is preserved. But of course, in our situation, we can regularize a bit the nonlinearity, and still the proof is true, and here you can really take hm with every m. But since I wanted to focus just in the pure power case, then the unique thing that we can do is to work with H2. But still you get a polynomial growth on a generic compact 3D manifold, which as far as you know was not proved elsewhere, and I don't see how the Burgain technology can work. Because here it is already a problem, the Cauchy theory in H1. Okay. Now, this is something, and just let me tell you why, by using the modified energy, we can go from double exponential to exponential. So the modified energy that we use are exactly the same I have introduced before in 2D, and you can use also in higher dimensions if you want. So this is the E2 that should play the role of H2 square, but it produces in the computation of the derivative such a cancellation that cancels the worst term. This is the key idea. On the contrary, but Patrick with his collaborator, they start by putting absolute value. They start with Duhamel formula, absolute value, and Minkowski. Okay? Here you don't use this. You start by computing ddt of E2. And if you compute this, you get this term, which is not complicated. The more complicated is this one, because you have dTu, that if you replace the equation, is a Laplacian u, but still to the power 1. Here you have Laplacian u to the power 2. Okay, so you have a lot of room to try to play the Grönwall lemma. And how to control this term in 3D? Well, it's really very simple, because simply you see, you put dTu in L2. This is essentially H2. Then you put this grad u square, you put in L6, and you get L2 W16 to the square, and you remain with this extra term u that you put in L6. Okay? This is just an order inequality. This L infinity L6 is under control just by, because you can control H1, so you end up with this quantity. Okay? So the quantity that before for them was L2 L infinity now becomes L2 W16. Okay? And the W16 you can deal without summing up the square, not by taking Minkowski, and you don't lose nothing when you sum up in some sense. Why? Let me give some details. So the starting point is the same Stricker's estimate as before, still localized at the frequency Pn, at the frequencies Pn. But before we started with the L, we took one half derivative, here we take one full derivative. Okay? You take this, and what to do? Now I don't sum up this quantity, I sum up the square. If you sum up the square on the n, I sum up also the square here, and I sum up also the square here. Now you see, the nice thing is that here I can use Plancharel. In the previous case, I had to sum up by using high frequency, low frequency. This term that before was our enemy, now is our friend, because it is for free L2 in time H3 over 2 square. But here, I have to sum up the squares. But it is not a problem, because you see, when I want to sum up this W16, project, I take the solution, I project on the with the Littlewood-Paley, I take L6 and sum up the square, essentially what is this norm? This is L6 in time, L6 in x, L2 in time, discrete L2 in n. But since 2 is smaller than 6, I can reverse the summability, I can put small L2 in time, and this is nothing else than L6 of the squared function. But L6 of the squared function by harmonic analysis is equivalent to L6. And so you conclude that you can really end up with this estimate, the same as before, by removing the projector, that I could do if I work with L infinity. This is the key point. And once you have this, now to control L2 W16 is essentially easy, because you see, I have L2 H3 over 2, and here this F becomes the nonlinearity. And here I just use Galliardo-Nierenberg inequality. I put h2 to the 1 half, h1 to the 1 half. This is conserved. This is h2 to the 1 half. When I take the square, I take 1. But I add another h2 before. So I take h2 square controlled with h2 square, which is a sharp case to apply exactly Grönwall, getting the exponential growth. No need to lose more on the exponential. Okay? And why in the subcubic you gain polynomial growth? Well, it is simple, because here I can work with 3 over 2 minus epsilon. So when I apply the Galliardo-Nierenberg inequality here, I take on h2 1 half minus epsilon. So I control h2 squared with h2 to 2 minus epsilon, which is what you need for the polynomial growth. Okay? So this is nothing else than that. So simply the idea is to combine the modified energy with the correct Stricker's estimate, to be careful when you sum up the square. Okay, so to be, and the nice thing is that you have the correct monotonicity between the exponent that allows you to interchange L6 and the small L2. And then you apply just a functional harmonic analysis result on the squared functions. And you get this exponential bound. Just one word, I said everything about H2. Okay. How to deal with H1 million, for example? Well, the point is that if you start to compute the modified energy associated with the power k of the Laplacian, it starts to be a bit nasty, the situation. But what is the idea? Well, instead of considering power of Laplacian, consider power of the time derivative. What is the advantage? Is that the time derivative, they are straight. So they commute very nicely when you apply Leibniz rule and so on and so forth. No need to take care of the Laplacian to to commute the Laplacian with other terms. And essentially, once you control this, then you have controlled this hk to summer 2. And so the correct modified energy at higher level order is this one. Okay? You have to compute is d in dt, which is not really nice, it is the result. But essentially, you can isolate two or three bad terms, and other terms can be controlled without dispersion, essentially. And the most at this point, you just apply Hölder-Brass Strickertz. I don't exclude that by combining now with the Bulgarian spaces, you can get even better things. And this is the situation. I want to say that the unique point where you use differential geometry is this identity, but you don't even use differential geometry because there is no curvature here. It is just an algebraic identity that you can compute chart by chart. And that's it. And I wanted to say one last slide to say how this technique we think can be used to improve further in 1D. Okay, if you look at the result we have proved, for instance, in 2D, of course, if you are on the 1D torus, I can consider every solution in the 1D torus as a solution in the 2D torus by a trivial extension. So the same bound we get on T2 should work for T, but we want to be a bit better. If you work to our result in T2, what we did, well, we get here the growth T. What I say is that at least for H2, we are able to prove that you get square root of T. And we have some computation showing that this is true in HM for general M, but you can gain other, you can gain something on T. And what is the new tools in 1D that we don't know how to use in 2D? Well, as usual, introduce the thing, but the key point is to introduce this quantity here, the capital N, the J, and the capital T, that satisfy this couple of transport equation. Okay? Why this? Because all the terms that you see when you write down the derivative of the modified energy can be written in terms of J, T, and N. And to have this nice solution, this nice relation, helps a lot. For instance, how does it help in our situation? Well, you see, what you get when you compute the second derivative, you get this term and this term here. For instance, one trivial relation between this term here and this term here is this one. You see, I rewrite I like this. I put dtn, then I have n dx u squared that can be written in terms of j and dx, and then like this, like j squared plus dxn squared. Then this dtn by the equation is minus dxj, so I have minus dxj j squared, and the terms coming from dxn squared is exactly 2. So you have a non-trivial relation between the first term and the second term. If I find another relation, I have done. And to find the other relation is to exploit now. Here I don't use the t, I use the t because the t involves this dx u square. I get another identity starting from the t, and at the end of the story, you have another system. You have a system satisfied by 1 and 2 that gives you something nice that you can control. Because you see here the nice thing is that at the end you have a relation telling you that this difference can be controlled by the integral of a term that involves 4 derivatives shared on every term. And once you have 4 derivatives shared on 4 terms, you can apply exactly this F4, which is exactly what you need to get the square root of T function. Of course, to do that for H, 1 million is not, we have some ideas, but this is the way how this modified energy can be exploited in the 1D to get even better bounds. And I think that I thank you very much, and I stop here.
Thank you. Questions?
In the case of 3D compact manifolds, of course, without any other assumption for the moment, the Strickertz inequalities we have are essentially optimal. But there are examples like, of course, the ORI, but also spheres or solved manifolds, for which, in fact, it's possible to solve up to the quintic, before the quintic. And in that case, it's certainly possible, using the Bourguignon spaces,
yes,
to get polynomial growth.
Yes.
Is that correct?
Yes, it's true.
But using your technique.
Using my technique, I didn't try, but for sure, once you have, for instance, if you look at the work by Tsvetkov, Er, and Tataru on T3, they can reach the Quintic, and the Pausader and Ionescu could deal the large data case. By using these UV spaces, I think that you can get polynomial bounds. By using my technique, I didn't try, but probably I didn't
probably
try.
As you did,
probably just by an elder. Yeah.
But except that
and the good thing here is that the Cauchy theory that you need is not in H1. It's in alpha Cauchy local Cauchy theory in H2. And all the tools of low regularity are needed just for the globalization, not for the local existence. So probably all the technicality needed when you ask for H1 are not needed. It's unclear. For me, the technique of Bouguen, if it works, to get the exponential bound in a generic 3D compact manifold. That's what I'm saying. Probably yes, but it's not completely clear. Unless you don't have extra structure that allows you to use the Bouguen spaces. Like T3, spheres, I agree with you. Yes?
The modified energy, do you have any intuition of what, does it have the physical meaning? Or
for me, it has just algebraic meaning. Just, I don't see really what's the point. But you see, the construction is that you have to do a step more compared with Bouguen. Just this DNDT you don't replace by the equation, but you extract another term of the energy. And you gain one power of the Laplacian for free, without any effort.
Should this
pattern
does not depend on bilinear estimates
No, absolutely not. This is the point. We don't use bilinear estimates. It just depends on Elder, if you Elder plus Strickarts. So just the linear Strickarts.
Okay, very good. So thank you again.